Thank you very much, indeed. Bless your heart. Thank you very much. Thank you so much. Well, ladies and gentlemen, it's time to beat time for the big time prizes, and it only remains for Mrs. Jogle of Southampton to do the word game. So here is our lovely and glamorous hostess, Yvonne, with Mrs. Jogle of Southampton. Oh, that's wonderful. We're going to have a lot of fun with beating time. Well, that really is wonderful to have you here. Thank you, Yvonne. Well, Mrs. Jogle of Southampton, if you just come over here. You have only to do the word game now. Would you open the curtains, please? And you have to make a well-known phrase or saying, and you have 50 seconds to beat the clock starting from now. A well-known phrase or saying. That's it. You're getting it, yes? You're getting nearer, yes? Well done!
Very much indeed, ladies and gentlemen. Jolly nice to be with you once again. Of course, when you're doing a show like this for one night only, you really don't get the polish that you get with a show that's on, say, five nights a week, regularly.
Children's Own Art Exhibition. Old age pensioners evicted for not paying their rent. Well, first of all, Anglo-German friendship.
My lords, ladies and gentlemen, pray silence for your chairman, Brigadier J.P. Windpipe, RNVR. Friends. Friends, I won't call you ladies and gentlemen because I know you so well.
Very good, sir, very good.
But to be serious, the time has come for us to ask ourselves some heart-searching questions. Are we any worse off now than we were before the war? Yes, it's a difficult question, but the answer is, of course, no. Economically, we are better off. But are we any better off spiritually? I know you must answer yes. We are not. But do we blame our German cousins for this lack of spirit? Of course we do. So, let us go forward with our German friends. Let us be firm. But understanding. Let us be strong, but compassionate. But above all, let us be consanguine pharmaceutical.
No, I never took a prisoner. I could have taken a German prisoner, but I didn't, and he was an officer. He was only a little chap, but I let him go. Well, I said to myself, what difference is it going to make to the war if one man is incarcerated? Yes. It won't make any difference at all, so I let him go. And I shall never forget the look of gratitude in his eyes. You could hardly see his eyes, actually. He had a lock of black hair coming down, covering them. And a little black toothbrush moustache. He looked a little bit like Charlie Chaplin. But there, good luck to him, I say. Off you go, I said. I say, Fritz, how about playing...
Pensioners who... The old age... Yes. Yeah.
Buckingham Palace, an imposing sight in the early morning sunlight. And here we see Her Majesty the Queen and Prince Philip. More than 30,000 people turned out to see them and to cheer them on their way. Truly one of the most magnificent spectacles in the royal year, as the royal filling in regal splendor. The dilapidated terrace house at just 17 shillings and sixpence per week. But even that is too much for the two old age pensioners. But then it was home. And the Dimpton-on-Sea Urban Council is just another eviction order. Isn't it time local councils used a little understanding and spared us the spectacle of witnessing pitiful sights such as these? Two inoffensive elderly people kicked out of their home, making their way who knows where by the only means of transport that they can afford.
The Rembrandts and Van Goghs of tomorrow hold their art exhibition today.
Believe it or not, was painted by a child of 8, Peter Durham from Dimpton. Quite remarkable, isn't it, for one so young? Well, one dedicated little painter is still painting away here. Now, let's see what you've been up to.
It is a lady. She have no clothes on. She have no dress, no shoes, no stocking, no knickers. She have no clothes on. It is a lady and a gentleman. He is a naked. They are both naked. He is very fond of the lady.
So he is. And what's your name?
Rodin, madame. Gaston Rodin.
24 hours, Monday night.
Okay, Cliff.
What stupid blood...
Ladies and gentlemen, during the past few years, Great Britain has produced very fine young film directors. Men like Christopher Borman and John Miles have already made their mark. But with me in the studio now is perhaps the most brilliant of our up-and-coming young directors, Mr. Freddie Scuttle.
Good evening, sir. Good evening,
Mr. Scuttle.
Good evening, viewers and cinema-goers.
Mr. Scuttle, you are described as the most brilliant of our young directors.
Yeah, I'm 23, sir.
You look considerably older.
I worry a lot.
Well, Mr. Scuttle, you've been quoted as saying that the current crop of British films falls roughly into two different categories.
Two categories, yes.
Yes, on the one hand, there are the Way Out films,
yes.
And on the other, the With It films.
Yes. Two categories, sir, yes.
Well, what's the difference?
That's what I say, sir. Who cares?
No, Mr. Scuttle, let me put it another way.
Put it whichever way you like, sir. It's entirely up to you, sir.
Well, take your latest film, Mr. Scuttle. Yes. Would you say that was a way-out film or a with-it film?
A way-out film, sir. And that is not just my opinion, sir. That is the opinion of the cricket, sir. They come to the press show the second it was on the screen, sir. Way out, they said. Where's the way out? They knew, you see, sir.
Well, take the current crop of spy films, like the James Bond series.
James Bond, yes.
Well, now, would you say James Bond was way out?
Oh, no, sir, no. Well, some of them... well-rounded actresses he works with, sir. That might be described as being way out, sir. You see my point, sir?
So you'd say James Bond was with it?
I should think he's never without it, sir. Not that I'm jealous, sir. Just envious, that's all.
Well, Mr. Scuttle, tell us a little bit about your latest film.
It's what we in the trade, sir, call a novel vague film. You see?
A novel vague film?
It's based on a vague novel. And it's called The Knock, sir. And it won the Film Festival Prize, sir.
But The Knack has already been made. That won the Cannes Film Festival Prize.
I don't know about that, sir. We won the Film Festival Prize, sir. Yes, yes.
What, at Cannes?
No, Chipping Sodbury, sir. We had a lovely festival, sir. All the big continental directors was invited, sir. Truffles was invited, sir. Fell in it.
Ingmar Bergman?
Her as well, yes. And the Italian one, Anthony Hunnian, was invited, sir.
Anthony Hunnian?
Yeah,
No, Mr. Scuttle, you mean Antonioni.
Yeah, Antonioni, yeah. I was going to write to him myself, but it was a little bit difficult, you know.
Yes, I think I know what it is. You can't spell Antonioni.
I can spell it, sir, I just don't know when to stop.
Mr. Scannell, who's starring in your latest picture?
My latest discovery, sir, mean, moody, magnificent Mervyn Twitt.
Yes, I remember from your latest press handout, Arthur Gardner describing him as tall, dark, and handsome.
Yes. Well, either that, sir, or tall and in the dark handsome. I'm not too sure, sir.
Viewers will be able to judge for themselves, because we're now going to show you a short excerpt from Mr. Scuttle's latest film, The Knock.
This is my story exactly as it happened. I was 30 years old and was considered by my several friends to be quite nice looking. But even so, I'd never had any success with the opposite lot. With that nice Miss Perelman at the dancing class. Somehow, she just hardly seemed to notice me. Nice blonde lady at number 27A. One of all the chaps used to talk about. Go wrong. Then one day, into my life came Barbara. She was the most beautiful creature I'd ever seen. She had the face and figure of a lovely young girl with the deep, understanding eyes of a deeply sensuous, full-blown woman. That moment on, I knew my life would never be the same again. Thank you. I would never be happy until I had made Barbara my wife. Being married to Barbara was like a dream come true. I never knew such happiness existed before. So much in common. After our wedding, something happened to change all that. As it happened.
Good evening. Well, tonight, SportsView looks to the future, to the Olympic Games in Rome in 1960. In the last Olympic Games, Great Britain achieved an outstanding success in the show jumping events. But what of the future? Peter Vernon went out last week to the Brodie Stables at Letchworth to interview that fine British horsewoman, Mrs. Emily Biscuit.
Mrs. Biscuit? Mrs. Biscuit?
Hello, can I help you?
Oh, now, Mrs. Biscuit, yeah? I know you must be frightfully busy, but I wonder if you could spare a few minutes to tell the viewers a little about yourself.
Well, I'm afraid I've got a filthy habit.
And what's that?
This one I'm wearing now. I just use it for knocking around in here, you know.
Yeah. Don't worry about that. Now, tell me to begin with, Mrs. Biscuit, how long have you been show jumping?
I have been show jumping since I was 17 years of age.
Mm-hmm.
So that'd be about 8 years ago. Yes, quite 8 years. Yes, it would. Yes.
And how many hours riding and jumping do you put in per day?
I would say about 10 hours a day.
Really? All those hours bouncing about on a horse? Doesn't it give you a headache?
No, quite the reverse. See, it's inclined to give the horse a headache. You see. Yes.
Now, this horse you're taking with you, you say, at the Olympic Games.
My pal.
My pal? Is that him in there?
He's in there, my pal. Hello, my pal.
That's his name, my pal. Do you ever get tempted to call him my pal Bob?
Oh, heavens, no. I couldn't very well call him my pal Bob, could I? I mean, he doesn't look a bit like Bob, but just a little, doesn't he? You may grow after it, of course, hope so.
Now, Mrs. Biscuit, during these 8 years that you've been riding and show jumping, you must have won an awful lot of trophies.
Oh, I've won a lot of awful trophies. I have, really. I have 12 statuettes, 24 medals, and a shield inscribed for the fastest mare in Surrey. I'm very proud of that.
Have you ever won a loving cup?
Well, I've never been in for that sort of competition.
Well, now, Mrs. Biscuit, have you any advice you'd like to give to girls who go in for show jumping? I mean, what would you say is the most important thing?
Well, I would say without a doubt, the most important thing to have is a horse. I mean, otherwise, there's very high fences.
I really meant apart from that.
Oh, well, I would say, I usually find when I'm show jumping, the first thing the judges look at is my seat. Because when I ride just as if I were part of the horse. I do, really. Wouldn't do to say which part, though, would it?
Well, I'm quite sure there must be a lot of horse lovers viewing tonight.
Yes.
So I wonder if we could coax my pal out for a minute or so.
Well, I am terribly sorry, really, because, you see, he's not terribly well. I'm just about to give him his horse pill, as a matter of fact.
Oh, really? I see. That's most interesting.
This one here.
Oh, now, tell me, how exactly is the pill administered?
Well, with the aid of this tube. Oh. You see, you place one end in the horse's mouth and the other end, and you put the pill in there, you see,
yes.
And you blow. I'll check. Come on, my pal, come along. Open your mouth. There's a good horse. There we are. Ready, steady. I'm afraid he blew first.
Oh, dear. Most unfortunate.
Doesn't matter. Of course, it doesn't have any, my taking that has no effect at all on my health.
Pleased to hear that.
But I'd love to stay here talking to you, but I'm afraid I've got an awful lot of things to do, you know, cleaning out all the stables and that, and the work just keeps piling up, you know, if you don't really understand. I'd love to.
I quite understand, Mrs. Biscuit, and thank you very much. We'll say goodbye.
Well, just before you go, I will try and get my pal just to say bye-bye.
Would you?
Yeah, I shall have to coax him, though.
Yeah.
I shall have to give him something to eat. He's very fond of his oats, you know. Come along, then. Come along, my pal. Say bye-bye. Say bye-bye.
Hello there. Welcome to another edition of Soapbox Jury. And let's see who we have on tonight's panel, shall we? Fred Curry, disc jockey. Hello there. Please guess how much a film star. Evening. Lady Edgware. Lady. And finally, Ted Crumble, film actor.
Hello.
Well, now let's see what they think of this one.
Thank you.
Lady Edgware.
Well, I liked it. It was gay, it was vivacious, and it had a most wonderful beat to it going all the time there. And I mean, of course, it was awfully nice. Of course, personally, I prefer my tunes a little more, if you'll pardon the expression, robust.
Oh, you mean like Mac the Knife?
Yes, like the sort of tunes he sings. Yes. The teenagers seem to like it out there, and they're the ones that will buy it, of course. You see, mind you, of course, I left my teens way back in 1957, but so I can't say for sure, but I do think it'll go up. I think it's awfully gay. I do really think, yes.
Ted Crumble.
Well, I found it most exciting. I mean, I think it had a wonderful beat and a wonderful backing, and I think it'll go up. So exciting.
Fred Curry.
I liked it. I really did. Although I felt that the introductory passage, that it'll run up on the piano, or as we in the business call it, an archipelago, was reminiscent of a track from the LP Elsie and Doris Waters in Las Vegas. I rather felt that. And I do feel this group owes an awful lot to Wingy Minone, Muggsy Spanier, Jelly Roll Morton, Victor Sylvester, to say nothing of Edmund O'Ross, the Irish band leader. But I would hazard a guess and say this disc will not go into the top 20 until the second week in April, when it will go in at number 16. And the week afterwards, of course, it will go to number 12, and the week after that, of course, it will leave the top 20. Of course, it's only a guess, you know, I could be wrong.
Lisa Gasometer.
Well, I liked it. I thought it was nice. I like the backing. And the fronting. Two sidings. Yeah. And I like that banjo that done all the twiddly bits. Or was it a trombone? Well, I like the rhythm and that. I liked it.
But do you think it'll go up?
Up where? Jim. Well, if enough people buy it, it will. That's obvious, isn't it?
Right, now, well, let's see how our jury are going to vote on this one. Well, they don't seem to be able to make up their minds, so we ask our audience judges what they think. And they voted her. Oops. That was a noisy one, wasn't it? Excuse me. Hello? Yes? Oh. I would seem that several viewers have phoned up and said that Miss Gasometer looks like she hasn't got a dress on the screen. Would you mind standing up, Lisa? See? Really, your minds. Bye now.
With you once all again. You know, since our last show, there has opened in London a brand new club, and this club is designed to cater to playboys and would-be playboys. So we thought the right person to go along and investigate was our old friend Jeremy Hawke.
Thank you very much. Good evening. Well, Scuttle's Fun Boy Club, according to the press handout, is, and I quote, Britain's answer to the geisha houses, a temple of feminine pulchritude and beauty, and the tired businessman's dream of paradise. Well, let's find out a little more about it from Mr. Fred Scuttle himself.
Good evening, sir. Good evening, viewers.
Good evening, Mr. Scuttle.
Welcome to Scuttle's Glamorous Fun Boy Club.
Thank you. Well, now, Mr. Scuttle, I believe your members are waited on by very beautiful waitresses.
Yeah, we do not call them waitresses, sir. They are not dressed as waitresses. They are dressed as cuddly little teddy bears, sir. More bear than teddy.
Well, now, how many of these girls do you employ?
At the moment, just the two, sir.
Only two?
The wife and her mother. But we are open to expand.
And what about the amenities?
Oh, we've got one each of those, sir. And we have a restaurant, sir, and a bar, sir. You can go get a drink. I have a vermouth with an olive in it, sir, or a vermouth with a cherry in it, sir. If you like, you can have a pint of mild and bitter with a pickled onion in it, sir.
And I suppose if a man feels like it, he could linger in the bar with something long and cold and full of vodka.
No, I don't allow the wife in the bar. I don't, you see, because he's...
Tell me, Mr. Scuttle, what other attractions does the club have to offer?
Oh, we have a drive-in movie, sir.
A drive-in movie?
What we call wall-to-wall carpeting. And then we have Scuttle's Fun Boy packaged holiday, sir. Holidays at popular prices.
Ah, well now, could you give us an example of one of these popular priced holidays?
Certainly, sir. 4 fun-filled days in sunny Clacton, 98 guineas.
98 guineas?
Yes, sir.
Well, that's not a popular price.
I like it, sir.
Have you anything a little cheaper?
Oh, you're from the BBC, aren't you?
Yeah.
With the hired suit. I should have known, sir. I didn't realize, sir. Oh, yes, the cheaper ones, yes, sir. Well, sir, there it is. You see, yes, for members only, sir. Because after investigation, I have found out, sir, that by securing the services of an ex-army surplus Dutch bulb barge, you see, night rate tourist class economy goods train, and a fleet of fast-moving, love-starved dromedaries, I can get a man into Outer Mongolia for 15 guineas and still show a profit.
15 guineas, I must say. That's remarkable, Mr. Scuttle. Yes, do they enjoy it?
We've never found out, sir. We've never had one come back, sir. They must like it, mustn't they, sir?
Mr. Scuttle, aren't you worried about bringing them back?
No, they pay in advance. You see, sir, yes. But we're wasting time out here, sir. We are digressing. Would you like to become a member?
I would very much, yes. I will get your cuddly little teddy bear.
Sandra!
She's just coming, sir.
Thank you.
You are going to have some fun tonight. You will be
there. There she goes. You see, sir, she will serve you drinks. She will twist with you. But remember, no touching.
I promise you I have no intention of molesting her.
I'm not talking to you, sir. I'm talking to her. No touching. She gets a bit handy.
Gracious me, I've just noticed the time, Mr. Cuddle. Yes, I really can't stay.
Just one moment, sir. The cabaret is about to start, sir. A striptease cabaret, sir.
Oh, well.
Beauty on a doll. You know what I mean, sir. All the wiggles and the squiggles, you know. You'll like it. There we are.
I'm sure I will, Mr.
Oh, you'll like our little stripper, sir.
I bet I... It's not her, is it?
Heavens above. Her sitting nose, sir.
What, me? Take me clothes off in public? Yes. No fear. I don't approve of it.
No, love. Mind you, your mother does it very well.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Come on, darling. Be quiet.
Bah!
know, the BBC has often been criticised for presenting far too many old films. So tonight we're going to put things right and present a film which was only made 3 months ago. And it is J. Arthur Klinker's very exciting The Stamp Collector.
Is anyone sitting there?
No.
Well, do you mind if I sit here, then?
Rich itself is a free country, isn't it?
Can I buy you a drink?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I hardly know you, do I? I mean, I'll have a small port, please.
Two ports, please.
Well, I don't usually drink with strange women, you know. I mean, one never knows where it might not lead to, does one?
Two ports.
Thank you.
Thank you. Keep the change.
Oh, thanks very much.
Oh, just look at that picture over there. Isn't it lovely?
Quite nice. Yeah.
Do you think it's a constable?
No, he looks more like a game warden the way he's dressed, doesn't he? Mind you, I don't think it's quite as nice as that picture over there. I think that one's got a lot more to commend it.
Yes. That one is lovely, but it's not as lovely as that one over there. Just look at the brushwork.
Mind you, I think the brushwork on that one over there is just as nice.
Yes, it is. But it's that one there. It's the detail that's so superb.
Yes. Mind you, I think the detail on that one over there is even superber.
Yes, I think you're right. Well, cheers.
Cheers, then.
Cheers.
You don't know what I know. Where am I? This is not my room. Where's Teddy? This is not my bed. Is anybody there? Let me out, I say. Let me out! You mustn't keep me locked up. I've got claustrophobia. Let me out. Help me, someone. Help me. Oh, please help me, someone. Please help me. Help me. Help me.
This room is soundproof, you know. Help. So you won't do any good by shouting.
Well, I won't bother then. Here. Why have you brought me here? It's not to have any, to do any, to have a bit. Nothing like that, is it? You know, I don't believe in that sort of thing. Well, not before marriage, anyway. And I'm none too sure about afterwards, either. Why have you brought me here?
Well, I collect beautiful things. And you know, you really are terribly handsome.
I know. I mean, there's no reason to lock me up, is there? And why pick on me? I mean, there's plenty of other fellas just as nice... almost as nice looking as what I am. Why me?
It's my hobby, you see.
What is?
Philately.
Well, that'll get you nowhere for a start, will it?
I've got a Siamese tickle.
What do you want me to do about it?
Would you like to see it?
No, thank you very much. I wouldn't.
There you are now. Isn't that beautiful?
If you don't mind, I should rather not look. Oh, like stamp collecting. Now, that's all right. That's quite a nice hobby, that.
Yes, but it's not enough. Don't you understand? I'm lonely. I'm so terribly lonely.
Well, I mean, don't carry on like that. I mean, you know the old saying, I mean, for every man there's a woman. I mean, you can't complain about that, can you?
I'm not complaining about it. I just want to get in on it.
Well, I mean, there's plenty of pebbles on the beach.
Then why don't you become a little bolder?
Look, I tell you what. Look, let's be chums. Look, I tell you what, if we are just chums and you let me go, I'll go out with you every Tuesday and Thursday. I promise, honestly, we'll go out together every Tuesday and Thursday.
Not enough.
You mean you want to marry me?
Yes.
That's silly, that'd spoil everything. I mean, we'd have nowhere to go Tuesdays and Thursdays, would we? Look, are you going to let me go or not?
You can't escape from here without the key, and I've got it.
If you don't give me that key, I shall come and take it off you by brute force.
Will you?
Yes, I will. No, I won't. Ah, but you've forgotten the telephone, haven't you? Ah, yes. Police, 9. 9. 9. We'll soon see about that. Hello, get me the police, please. Hello, is that the police? I'm being held prisoner in a... Where is this place? Ah, it's Sloane 2092. Yes, officer. There's a wicked, evil woman here. She's holding me hostage. No, me hostage. I said she's holding me hostage. Well, you think that's clever, don't you? But there's more than one way of getting out of here. You've forgotten the window, haven't you, eh? Yes, you...
Yes, it's a long way down, isn't it?
You don't mind, I'd rather not look. I get what they call virtuous.
Oh, we can't have that, can we? Now, look here. You sit down there and relax. You might even get to like it here in time. We might even become more than just friends. Hmm.
Look, if you don't let me go, I'll destroy myself. I should jump out the window. I promise I will. I'll do it. I'm going to jump. Farewell, world. Farewell, mother that bored me. I'm going to jump.
Oh! Oh, dear. That poor boy. He jumped out of the window. Jumped out, and at a time like this. With the kitchen on fire. Smoke pouring through the sitting room. Any minute now, the whole apartment is going to be burnt to a cinder. What shall I do? What shall I do?
Save the furniture.
Come along.
Save the furniture.
Come out of that wardrobe. Look, why don't you come and sit down and relax? It's much nicer out here.
How can I relax? My mother will be expecting me. I'm supposed to be taking Elsie out tonight.
Elsie? Who's Elsie?
She's my intended. I mean, we're secretly and unofficially engaged.
Well, what has this Elsie got that I haven't got?
Well, nothing, only she hasn't had it for quite so long.
Give you all the good things in life. I'm a very rich woman.
Yes, I know. It's all right for you. You've got money. You're taking advantage of me because I'm poor, aren't you? I mean, I come from a poor family, you know. My parents couldn't even afford to buy me clothes as a child. I couldn't go out anywhere. I had to walk around the house naked till I was 16.
And then what happened?
They bought me a top hat so I could look out the window.
Have a piece of cake.
No, thank you. I'm not hungry. I mean, I'm the breadwinner in the family. Now, my father won't go to work. He won't get out of bed. And the only exercise he ever gets is sticking his finger into chocolates to find out which ones have the soft center. You don't do that now they put the design on the lid.
Just a small piece.
Well, just a small piece, then,
all
I
right.
will have. And, I mean, my father says all he wants for Christmas is bed socks, a bottle opener, beer and a bucket. I mean, what sort of a life is that? No, just that there, about there. Oh, that's please. It, like that. That'll do lovely. Thank you very much. Well, it's quite nice, isn't it?
Would you like some champagne?
Yes, I would. You got any fags?
Oh, fags. Cigarettes.
forgot them. Oh, whatever made me forget the cigarettes? Look, wait there, wait there. I shan't be very long.
Very
I'll just pop out and get them.
She's left the door open. She hasn't locked the door. I can escape. I'll be able to see my little home again before they pull it down to put up a slum. I'll be able to have some of my sister's flaky pastry. It's like eating a wet book. And I shall see my goldfish again, my goldfish, the only ones in the house who open their mouths without asking for something. I shall be able to see Elsie again and her mother and talk about the wedding and the little council house we're going to have and how her mother and father are going to come and live with us. And her brother as soon as he gets out of Borstal. And all that. What am I talking about? I say, you left the door open!
That's more like it.
Oh, this is a lovely...
Hollywood and the stars. Throughout the history of motion pictures, there have been many successful and enduring partnerships.
In the late 20s, three comedians forsook the Broadway stage for the movies. They were the Marx Brothers.
Hey, where you been?
You found a baby? You found a woman? What's her name? Jewelry? What's the name of jewelry? That's a, Julie! You have found the Julie, the one with the microfilm. Where is the microfilm? What is that, the scout's honor? You're not a boy scout. No scout, huh? But honor. Honor! The microfilm is honor. Come on, we gotta go get her then.
Don't you just wish there were four Marx Brothers?
Certainly, no husband and wife team ever received more adulation than Richard Burton and Elizabeth Taylor, seen here in Who's Afraid of Lavinia Wolf?
Well, come on, will ya?
All right, honey, keep your shirt on.
You know I like plenty of ice in my glass.
You know you always chew it.
I do not chew my ice.
I was talking about the glass.
Get nodded.
You've never read Einstein's theory of relativity, have you?
I have so, too. And I think he was wrong.
You don't know anything about anyone in this whole wide world. You don't know who Einstein is, but I do, because I go to night school every Tuesday and Saturday.
Big deal.
You don't know who Darwin is, do you? But I do, because I go to night school every Tuesday and Saturday. You don't know who Pablo Picasso is, do you? But I do, because I go to night school every Tuesday and Saturday.
You don't know who Sam Gluckstein is, do you?
No, I'll admit I don't know who Sam Gluckstein is. Who is Sam Gluckstein?
He's the guy who comes around here every Tuesday and Saturday while you're at night school.
Probably the most successful partnership ever was that of Stan Laurel and Oliver Hardy.
Yeah. Oh, Stanley, come here.
Come on!
Another fine mess you've got me into.
The early 40s gave us Sidney Greenstreet and Peter Lorre.
He's here, sir.
Sidney mean.
Sir, I have made a terrible mistake.
Life is very cheap in Casablanca.
Put me down!
You mean we can't send the gold by the railways?
There are no trains.
But you said you heard trains.
I thought I heard trains, but it wasn't trains. It was German prisoners of war passing sandbags to each other. And they are very polite. And they were saying, and bitteschön, and dankeschön, and bitteschön, and dankeschön, bitteschön, dankeschön, bitteschön, dankeschön. It wasn't trains at all.
The musicals had their king and queen, Nelson Eddy and Janet McDonald.
I wanted to forget you and leave the past behind.
Still, the magic moment when I met you seems to stay forever in my mind. The sky was blue. High above,
the moon was new, and so was love. This eager heart of mine is singing, lover, where can you be?
You came at last,
you came at last.
Love had its day,
love had its day.
That day is past,
that day is past. You've gone away. The heart of mine is singing, oh, lover, come back to me.
When I remember every little thing you used to do, I'm so lonely.
Every road I've walked along, I've walked along with you. No wonder you were lonely.
The moon is new.
The moon is new.
But love is old.
But love is old. And while I'm away, here, this heart of mine is singing, lover, come back to
...1954, on the waterfront, with the superb performance of Rod Steiger, matched only by the brilliance of Marlon Brando.
Look, you're my brother. I don't want to see you get hurt. Look, all I'm asking is for you to go along with these guys. Look, you're a smart, intelligent boy.
I know. But they can't
is that only way to talk to your brother?
Look, maybe lost on the one that got fate and then I got to go.
You know, Terry, sometimes I just don't understand you.
What's doing out back?
He's 44th on 33rd Street.
What do you say, Mac?
He's 44th on 33rd Street.
How's that again, Mac?
Look, you don't let no diver get grown 40 days to clean up water again, eh?
Oh, why didn't you say so in the first place, Mac?
The late 30s brought together Beauty and the Beast, Mae West, and W.C. Fields.
Oh, bartender, give me a shot of rye and a glass of water. Thank you. Yeah.
How's the wife?
Yeah, better than nothing, I guess. Give me a shot of snake, huh? Love a boy. What do they call you, my dear? It's none of your business. What do they call me? Lulu Bell. Lulu Bell! What are you from West Appalachia? What are you, a hired help or something? Hired help? Why, heavens to Betsy. You're not a fuddy-duddy, are you? You're not a moon calf. Well, hell, you know my father was a mayor. What was your mother, a jockey? Why, my father made the Empire State Building. My father made the Brooklyn Bridge. My father made the Great Boulder Dam. What did your father ever make? Look me over, big boy. Just look me over. Reminds me, must get my watch fixed.
And so ends the partnerships of Hollywood and the stars.
Ladies and gentlemen, this little folk song you're hearing at the moment comes from Central America, and it is virtually the national anthem of the small town of Huevas. And Huevas has the distinction of having the highest birth rate in all of Central America. And a lot of people hold that Juan Santos is responsible for this. He's 97. But a very sprightly 97. And he is the local train driver. And he drives his train through Huevas every morning at 5 o'clock and blows his whistle.
Loudly.
And wakes everybody up. And at 5 o'clock in the morning, it's too early to get up and go to work. And it's too late to go to sleep again. And I wish I was dead, but the Huarache Indians actually live up in the hills near Huevas, and they come down once a year, and they have a big luau or a feasting, you know, and they get tanked up on this tequila and cenepot essence, and it really gets you going, that stuff. And they go potty, you know, they go running around. I really didn't mean that. They go mad, they go running around on red-hot coals and upturned knives and broken glass, and it doesn't hurt them a bit, because they wear big hobnail boots. But actually, boots have only very recently come to the Indians, you know. Until 1933, they didn't have any boots, you know. I mean, before 1933, you could have gone up to one of these Indian Huaraches and you'd have said, boots, you know, or cobblers, or something. And he wouldn't have understood what you meant, but now they've got boots, and the first one to have a pair of boots was so proud. He said, hey, Juan, you see what I got here? I got my boots. Hey, muy bien, muy guapa. Si, si, si. Pardon, you want to go to the Gran Vía? He's first on the right, he's second on the left, and straight ahead. You have to excuse me now. I'm going to tie up my boots lace. They do. And of course, nowadays, you know, a lot of tourists come down from North America, you know, from California. They come down all loaded up with cameras, you know, and they go around photographing everything inside. They go, oh, look at that, Harry. Isn't that great? Hey, Alice, look at that. Oh, wonderful. Oh, look. Isn't that just fabulous? Oh, you... I wrote some words for this song. I think it's rather lovely. I asked a policeman in Portsmouth the way to the YMCA. You turn left, he said, then you go straight ahead. I said thanks and I went on my way. Then I saw her. She was in a pub doorway and I saw the way she was dressed. Her blouse was so low that I murmured, oh, as I saw her pink woolly vest. Oh, sailor, I'm lonely, she whispered, and she smiled, and she gave me a flower. Then round to her place we casually strolled at 70 miles an hour. The moments that followed thereafter are moments I'll never forget. I kissed her hands and I kissed her face, and if I'd stayed I'd have been kissing her yet. Then a knock at the door, it was her husband. She said, jump out the window, he's vicious. I said, you must be joking, we're 13 floors up. She said, darling, don't be superstitious. Then he burst in and he rushed straight up to me. I thought I was in for a fight. He said, you've gone the wrong way for the YMCA. You should have turned left and not right.
Now be a short interval. The sales staff will visit all parts.
Look at her, right?
We had together. They were good times, weren't they? Weren't they, Harry?
Sure were. They sure were.
You know what I remember about you, Harry? It's the way you smile. You know, every time you smile, your nose sort of crinkles up. It always fascinated me, the way it sort of crinkles up. You're still drinking, Harry. Why are you? Do it, Harry. It was your drinking which split us up the last time. But if you give it up, right here and now, you can have me back, Harry. Well, which is it to be?
Give me another bourbon.
Very well, Harry. If that's how it's going to be, you'd better take your ring back.
Oh, come on, Stella. Don't be like that.
I mean it, Harry. I want you out of my life for good. Now, here. Take your ring back.
Okay, honey, if that's the way you want it.
Now go. Go on. Get out of my life, Harry. Get out of my life, please.
Sure, honey, if that's how you want it.
Harry, come back. Please come back, Harry. I need you.
Okay, honey. I'm here.
Harry, I want you to know, and I mean this, I want you to know that whatever you do, no matter what, and wherever you go, no matter where, no matter what happens, either now or in the future, or at any time, I want you to know that. Oh, Harry, I love you so very deeply. I love you, I love you. I've never loved anyone else.
You know what day it is today?
What?
It's our anniversary. Don't you remember? 3 years ago to this very day in this very bar, we met for the very first time. And here, I got a little present for you.
Oh, no, Harry. I just couldn't.
Oh, go ahead. Take it.
Oh, I can. Oh, Harry, a diamond necklace. Oh,
no one's too good for you, baby.
Oh, Harry, how can I ever thank you?
We'll think of something.
Hello, Anthony.
Why, hello there, Scarlet.
Mind if a lady sit here?
Be my guest.
Do you mind if I smoke?
Go right ahead.
It's great seeing you again, Harry. You haven't changed a bit. Same old Harry, same old smile. Sort of crinkly. It sort of makes your nose crinkle up. I like that. Not still going around with that little waitress, Harry. You don't need her. You need me, Harry. We need each other. You are all man, and I am all woman. Kiss me, Harry. Kiss me.
Okay, Harry, this is it. Don't look around. Straight ahead. Don't try anything. Just get those hands up. I said to get them up. Drop it, Tony. Okay, copper. You asked for it.
Oh,
taking you in, Harry.
You've got nothing on me, Lieutenant.
Harry, you're a three-time loser. And with a three-time loser, there's only one way